I'm on these tarpals since I have an asthma to reduce myself. I teach at Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. Right now I am based in Shimla. I am working as a fellow at IIS Shimla. That's by way of my introduction. And for this August gathering, I have this sense of trepidation because I have not come here with a full paper. I have just few disjointed points, and hopefully some of these points will make some sense. The first thing, and I will take my cue from chairperson, Professor Hitler's house remarks, and he said it in a different language. He talked about sanitation and civilization. I would put it differently. I would submit to the house that for any serious considered discussion of sociology of sanitation, we need to begin with what I would call a historical mapping of the twin notions of civic consciousness and the notion of the public space. And we have to see how these twin notions have unfolded themselves, maybe in their great historical time. But since I don't have much knowledge about the historicity of these notions, and I'm sure that my friend Sanan will have his ideas on this, so I leave it to him. But at least some of us, as students of sociology, do venture into, as part of our job, into what we call the colonial context, the colonial formation. And then I would just like to bring to your attention the works of two historians, and they have written, and it's my submission that it's the historians, at least the historians of colonial India, who have tangentially, in a very marginal way, they have engaged with these notions of civic consciousness and the public space. And I'm referring to Sudipta Kaviraj and Vikesh Chakravarti, the works, the essays of by these two writers. But I have again, and I think some of you will again will have problems the way they put before you the disjunction between the colonial understanding of hygiene, public health, and sanitation, and the natives. I'm sorry to use this term, but of course, the natives' understanding of hygiene, sanitation, and public health. And they will just try to essentialize in a way as if the trend would never meet, and it has never met, that how these twin, these disjunctions have always been there, and they have never met. So on the one hand, we had the colonial government's injunctions, you know, the municipal notice boards on walls that don't do this, don't do that, concerning sanitation and health and hygiene, and the natives' use of the public space in their own ways. So this disjunction, in my reading, in my limited understanding, creates some problems for us. And these problems are that, you know, that to an extent, some of these writers, some of these historians go on, and for the want of a better term, I would say they go on romanticizing the native's point of view. You know, so if you read Sudipta Kaviraj, you have the great evocation of the romanticized Deshapriya Park in Calcutta. You will have in Dipesh Chakravarti's work that you will have the great evocation of the great act of defiance, the defiance of the colonial power when 10 Indian men are urinating under the banner to say that please do not urinate here in a street in Calcutta. So this, I think we have to be a bit wary of this notion of, this romanticized notion of the incompatibility of the colonial and the I would say, and the natives' points of view regarding this issue. That's the first point. Secondly, and these disjunctions do not end with merely the colonial rulers. In fact, some of these writers, and we know, they forge it a sort of, some sort of continuity between the colonial ways of constructing subjecthood and the post-colonial colonial ways of constructing rather manufacturing citizenship. So in that larger conceptual context, sanitation as an issue becomes part of the larger complex of how do you manufacture citizens in a diverse country like ours, out of multitudinous communities. So sanitation, the issues of sanitation take into the larger issues of the reach, the depth of citizenship and their right, civic consciousness in the notion of public. That was my first point. Secondly, and again it relates to this point, and since, and if we agree for a moment that there is this continuity between the colonial and the post-colonial, then we will not be wondering that why so many official programs of sanitation, they fail to reach their particular desired targets. So we have just heard the minister, Nirmal Bharat Yojana, or total sanitation campaigns, and so many other things. But as we also know that most of these campaigns, I mean, they have their own incentives, monetary incentives, through grants, through subsidies and all that. But they never succeed. And it's not merely, I don't want to talk that they don't succeed merely because we have too much of corruption in the system. I think the point is larger. And the point is that this perceptual gap, the perceptual gap between the official discourse on sanitation or hygiene or public health and the way the masses, the wapulwa, live it out in their everyday lives, these perceptual gaps have structural coordinates. And that's why I will just give you an illustration. Just almost a decade back, I was doing some field work in Karimnagar district of Andhra Pradesh. And there, what I found was that, you know, in most of the houses in a particular village, the poor people had swanky toilets. Swanky in the sense of compared to the residents or the huts that they had. And what they had done, they were not using these toilets. Of course, they had constructed these toilets out of the grants that they had received. But they were not using it for that purpose, that ostensible purpose, but they were using toilets for storing food grains. And this reveals a lot, because the toilets were the most beautiful portions of the buildings or the residences they had. And that's why they were using it for the most precious items that they could ever have food grains and for storing food grains. What I am trying to hint at is that, and this is where we have to bring in the, what I would say, the notions of the economic status of the household. We can't simply blame the poor that they have no sense that toilets are should be used for toilet purposes and not for storing food grains. That's the second point. Number three, and I think, again, Mr. Jha referred to that, and in sociological language, what we say, social stratification. And I think it's part of received wisdom that we have to look into the implications of social stratification for an understanding of complex sociology of sanitation. In other words, what I'm arguing is that sanitation is not merely a function of larger public culture. It's not merely a function of larger public culture. It has its linkages, rather intimate linkages. It has its intimate linkages with the differing notions of human dignity. And human dignity is asymmetrically distributed. We all know that we don't grant the same level of dignity to all individuals. And just to illustrate, and we see it before our own eyes, that you see all those huge swanky buildings that keep coming up every day. But if you go to those work sites, you hardly have toilet facilities for the workers who work there throughout the day. And I am telling you from my experience of Institute of Management Calcutta, which has got plenty of money and constructing huge buildings. And there what we do is that we pass on the blame to the contractors. We say that, look, this is not our job to construct toilets on work sites for these daily wage workers. Anyway, daily wage workers, you know, they are part of the rather informal economy and things like that. But so the idea is that any discussion on sanitation, and as we have been doing this consistently, has to factor in consciously and deliberately this the idea of the worth of human dignity and how we have to. We should salvage this notion of human dignity from the different hierarchical groups that it has historically wanted. And the last part that I have to mention that is that, and this may sound a bit controversial, but in my, again, partial and limited reading, I firmly believe that we never had a sociology of sanitation, but rather we had was a sociology of visual purity and pollution. And these are two different worlds altogether. I mean, the sociology of ritual pollution and purity and sociology of sanitation, they are not one and the same. When we are talking of sanitation, we are essentially, necessarily talking of a modern discourse. And there is no natural translatability between ritual purity and cleanliness or hygiene. One does not follow the other. So if we are ritually pure, it does not mean that we are also going to be living in hygienic and good conditions. And I need not belabor this point. As a child, I have memories of dharmashalas in a pilgrim place in Deoghar, in Bihar, what is now Jharkhand. You see the conditions of those dharmashalas. All just Banaras, we saw a documentary, the Banaras huts and all, the dirt and the filth of Banaras huts. But what I'm trying to say is that I'm not into this blame game of only that these ritual purists and priests, they have no sense of hygiene and sanitation. That's not my point. I'm saying that even right from the sacred complex to the secular, we have almost near absence of these sanitation facilities. You go to, I'm talking of Khar Market in Delhi. You go to Khar Market and their toilet complex, you would find that urinals are free for God's sake, but the toilets are always under lock and key. You go to many shopping complexes and malls, and even in universities, where toilets are exclusively meant for faculty members. If I happen to be a visitor in a department, and if I have to use the toilet, I have to know someone in the faculty and request the cumbersome process of the key and then open and all that. And there are places where these things never cross our mind that we need sanitation facilities. I can give you, and this is my last illustration. There is a correspondence course office as part of Lalit Narayan Mithila University, Darbhanga. And there, every Sunday, hundreds of students from far off interior villages come to attend classes on Sundays. And large number of them are girls. And you would be shocked to know that it has never crossed the minds of universities, authorities, that they should have some toilet facilities, at least for girls, because it's assumed that men will always urinate in the open, should have some toilet facilities for them. So in our own perceptual ranking of things that we need for dignified living, I don't know, historians will investigate and share with us their wisdom, that somehow we have always put sanitation, and I insist that sanitation as a modern discourse, we have always put it on the back burner. And that's why I think that it's a good beginning, and all of us should collectively start scratching our heads at how we can integrate this sociology of sanitation with the old and hackneyed sociology of ritual purity and pollution that we have always done.
Question, am I audible? I think I'm audible.
Yeah. We have a mic.
My name is Shahina Khanda. I'm Shahina Khan. I'm a professor for broadcasting. Listening to you, I think we have to go a step further. And I just jotted out two words. One is sensitizing, and another is raising awareness. Because across the board, you've talked about.
But a very fine point that hasn't been raised until now is the idea of citizenship and sanitation that the link you were making. And I was wondering, it's not really a question, but in terms of reconsidering, in terms of that instituting citizenship, thinking about public spaces, and its sort of implication in urban planning and imagination of planning itself, which then sort of finally imagines citizens as such. And, you know, so it's not really a question, but I was wondering if you could sort of flesh it out.
Any other question? Any other question?
Was somebody hand there?
Actually,
yes,
you want to react to it?
Yeah. I think both these interventions were by way of comments. To add, I mean, while I agree with that it's a question of using toilets and not as storage houses, but we also have to, just my submission also, that we also have to look at other side of the picture where we have not been able to offer those facilities. If we look at our own urban slums, the shanty towns, the jogi jhopris and all, So those are larger structural issues. What I'm trying to say is that all these things, and your points are well taken, we need awareness, we need consciousness raising and all that, but we also have to inch along and ease towards larger structural issues. And that's where I think Pripta's point of urban planning and things like that come up and isolated. And also if you look at the, we know that all these places, urban planning is not in that sense neutral. I live in Golf Club Road in Calcutta, I pay more taxes, so every morning I have two sweepers cleaning the street in front of my house. But just right behind my house, we have this Ambarsha Road, Jhupri Jhopris, where large number of Muslims would live, and we don't have the same municipal facilities for that. So the idea is that, and we also see the disparities that are so huge in urban spaces. So in that sense, I take your point that But how to make it inclusive? And there the larger issue of politics. I mean, it's also the politics of the urban poor and where they're figuring in this larger politics that comes up.
Yeah, and I think that whole issue of sensitization and all of those things, that's relevant. But at the same time, I find it problematic.
Thank you, Dr. Manish Thakur.